Today's class is on anatomy of ear. So anatomy of ear can be divided into that of the external ear, middle ear and inner ear. So the external ear comprised by pinna and external auditory canal. So we can go through that. External ear. External ear is divided into pinna and external auditory canal. So it is divided into pinna and external auditory canal. So this pinna is unique and it is different in each individuals. But there are some constant features that we can go through. So, it's the auricle or the pinna. This pinna is made up of a framework of single piece of yellow elastic cartilage, and also there is a lobule. So, this part is a lobule. Okay. So, this pinna is made up of a single piece of yellow elastic cartilage. Except the lobule, and this lobule is formed by a fat covered by skin, this part. So this part is fat covered by skin, it is called a lobule, and this is a piece of yellow elastic cartilage. Okay. The pinna has got a This is a lateral surface. Outside is a lateral surface, and the part which is attached to the skull or which is facing the skull skin is a medial surface. So this is the outside is a lateral surface, and the skin on the lateral surface, this part, it is attached to the or adhered to the perichondrium. But it is on the medial surface, it is comparatively looser, and the epithelium is keratinizing squamous epithelium. So this is a lateral surface, and the other part, inner part, is a medial surface, and the skin covering this part, lateral surface, is tightly adhered to the perichondrium, and it is comparatively loose on the medial surface, and the skin is epithelium is keratinizing squamous epithelium. And on the lateral surface there are various elevations and depressions. The first one is the helix. So this is the helix. Helix of pinna. This is the first elevation. It's the helix of pinna. Helix again has got a crest of helix. This is a crest of helix, and this is the ascending limb of helix. Ascending limb of helix, and this is a helix proper. And on the helix, you can see a Darwin's tubercle, a tubercle, or an elevation. In some pinna, you can see an elevation here. And it is called the Darwin's tubercle. Okay, so that is about the helix. And next elevation is the antihelix. So when there is a helix, there will be an antihelix. This is the antihelix. And this antihelix is divided into an anterior crest and a posterior crest. So this is antihelix. So helix and antihelix. For easy understanding, along with me, you can palpate or touch your own pinna and find out all these things. So touch your helix, okay, and touch your antihelix, divided into an anterior crest and the posterior crest, and in between these two crests you have the triangular fossa. This is triangle shaped and this part is a triangular fossa. And another important landmark is the tragus. In the front part you have the tragus. Okay, you have the tragus. This is your tragus. This part, just tragus lies just in front of the external auditory canal. This is your external auditory canal. So, this is the tragus and this is the antitragus. This part is the antitragus. And another important cartilage is the congal cartilage. This whole part is a congal cartilage. Congal cartilage is actually a concavity. This part. It's a congal cartilage. And this is a conga. Okay. And another important part. This part of conga. Here it is a simba conga. Simba conga. Simba conga is important. On palpating here, you get the simba conga, and that is important. You know, the simba conga actually comes here, this part. The simba conga is important because in adulthood, that is an important landmark, and it directly overlies the mastoid antrum. So that is one of the most reliable point for palpating, eliciting the tenderness of mastoid. Okay, mastoid tenderness. You can, by pressing here, you can elicit mastoid tenderness, and this is one of the most reliable points for eliciting mastoid tenderness. So, I have discussed on this helix with the crest of helix, ascending limb of helix, and Darwin's tubercle. Then, anterior antihelix with an anterior crest and a posterior crest, and in between comes the triangular fossa, and between the helix and the antihelix, this part is the scaphoid fossa. This is a scaphoid fossa, and there is conga, there is simba conga. Simba conga is a point for eliciting mastoid tenderness, and there is tragus and there is antitragus. This regarding the developmental anatomy of ear, it is already discussed in my earlier class on anatomy and developmental anatomy of ear, nose and face. So pinna is fully formed at birth and it reaches adult size by 5 to 6 years. So at birth, fully formed, adult size by 5 to 6 years. Okay, this is important because one of the congenital anomalies of the ear, in all congenital anomalies of the ear, the treatment is otoplasty. So, otoplasty surgery is done usually after attaining 5 to 6 years, because at that time only the pinna reaches the adult size. Okay. So, that is about the anatomy of auricle. Then about the cartilage. Another important term. Cartilages, I have already told that here is the this yellow elastic cartilage, except the auricle, I told you already. So this cartilage, this comes the helical cartilage and the congal cartilage, and there is a part here between this part, tragus and the ascending limb of helix. Between ascending limb of helix and the tragus, one part is devoid of cartilage. And this part is called incisura terminalis, this part. It comes here. Okay, this part. This part is called the incisura terminalis. This part, we call it as incisura terminalis. Okay, this part is incisura terminalis, and that is part in which we do it through this incisura terminalis. We go for an endoral incision, because incisura terminalis is devoid of cartilage. So in Lambert's endoral incision, that incision is put in the incisura terminalis, because there is no chance of damage to the oral cartilage, right? Actually, this part comes like this one. And your oracle. So that becomes the thinner. Okay. And the clinical significance, the most important, I told you about the simba conca. Then comes the incisura terminalis. Then adult size importance is because autoplasty. We go for autoplasty. Then by 5 to 6 years of age. And developmental defect. And another developmental defect is the preauricular sinus. Actually, we get a preauricular sinus somewhere here in PAS, preauricular sinus. Okay, preauricular sinus. This is because of the defect in the fusion between the first and second arch. Preauricular sinus is due to defect in the fusion of first and second arch. Okay. Second arch. Then, so developmental defect mainly occurs. Next is the external auditory canal, which is developing from the first pharyngeal cleft, and it is only cartilaginous part. It has two parts, a cartilaginous part and a bony part. This cartilaginous part is fully formed by birth, and the bony part develops completely by at a later stage. Okay. So this extends from the bottom of the congenital cartilage. This is a concha. This extends from bottom of the congoid cartilage up to the tympanic membrane. This is tympanic membrane. Okay. This is tympanic membrane. So it extends from bottom of the congoid cartilage up to the tympanic membrane. This is not a straight tube. It is actually, it is S-shaped. You can see the S shape. It has got an outer cartilaginous part, this part, and an inner bony part. Okay, and this is S shaped also. S shaped like this. This is S shaped. This part. And this outer cartilaginous part is directed upwards, backwards, and medially. This is upwards, backwards, and medially. And bony part is directed downwards, forwards, and medially. Both are medially, upwards, backwards, and medially. And this one, downwards, forwards, and medially. So, cartilaginous part is directed upwards, backwards, and medially. And the bony part is directed downwards, forwards, and medially. That is why, on looking from here, we will not see the complete tympanic membrane. So, for that, we have to pull the pinna upwards, backwards, and laterally. Pull pinna. Pinna, this pinna has to be pulled upwards, backwards, and laterally. We have to pull the pinna upwards, backwards, and laterally to see the complete visualization of the tympanic membrane. Okay, so this is an S-shaped tube. 24 millimeters in size, extending from the bottom of the congoid cartilage up to the tympanic membrane. It has got an outer cartilaginous part and an inner bony part. This cartilaginous part is around, it is total 24 millimeter. This cartilaginous part is 8 millimeter. And this part, bony part, will be 16 millimeter. Okay. So of the 24 millimeters, 8 millimeters of the cartilaginous part and and the inner part is the bony part, which is 16 millimeters. And in the cartilaginous part, remember some very few things. One is fissures of Sandorini, because in the floor of this there are fissures of Sandorini. So Sandorini. Okay. Fissures of Sandorini, and these are very small defects in the external artery canal, and through this infections will spread from here. Infections as well as neoplasms will spread from, in front is the parotid area and behind is the mastoid area. So through this fissures of Sandorini, infection and neoplasms will go and also come into the external artery canal from parotid as well as the mastoid area. Okay. And also the skin in this area is very thick here, and it contains hairs also. Thick skin containing hair. Hair is present only in the cartilaginous part. There is no hair in the bony part. So the skin is thick here and it has hairs also. When you draw the hair, it can grow like this. Okay. So it has hair and thick skin. Thick skin. Hair also and thick skin here. And it also has ceruminous and pilosebaceous glands. Ceruminous glands and pilosebaceous glands. What is that? The ceruminous and pilosebaceous glands secrete wax. So the production of wax is from this part. So the skin is thick here and it has hair present, and also ceruminous and pilosebaceous gland is secrete wax. And also because hair follicles are present, chance of folliculitis is present only in the cartilaginous part. So cartilaginous part is 8 millimeters. The skin overlying is thick, containing hair follicles and ceruminous and pilosebaceous gland, and also contain defects or fissures of Sandorini, which causes spread of infection from the parotid and also from the mastoid area. Okay. Coming to the bony part. Bony part is formed by the temporal bone. Of temporal bone, mainly from the tympanic portion of the temporal bone, bony part. Here is the, actually this is from temporal bone. So this bony part, the roof is formed by the squamous. So main part of the bony part is from the tympanic portion, and roof is from the squamous portion of temporal bone. So tympanic and squamous. A small part of petrous bone also contributes. So what you say, the bony part is formed mainly from the tympanic portion of temporal bone, and the roof is formed by the squamous portion, and also a very small contribution from the petrous bone. So tympanic bone, tympanic part of temporal bone, squamous and petrous. That is a bony part, and it is 16 millimeter. The skin is very thin here. Thin skin. No hair follicle, and also there is no glands. In this, you have to remember only two names. One is an isthmus. Isthmus. Isthmus is the narrowest part of the external artery. It comes around here. It's the narrowest part. Isthmus. The importance is that foreign body. Isthmus. The importance is that it is the narrowest part of the bony part of external artery canal, and any foreign body, if gets lodged medial to this, it will be difficult to take it out. So it becomes an impacted foreign body. So that is isthmus. It is around 6 millimeters from the tympanic membrane. Okay, that is isthmus. And another term is the foramen of Peschke. Okay, foramen of Peschke. What is that? This anteroinferior part of the bony external artery canal has got a defect here, named by foramen of Peschke, and through this infections will come from the parotid gland. So this here, it is a fissure of Sandorini, and then the bony part, it is a foramen of Peschke. Thin skin, no hair follicle. The another most constricted part is the isthmus also. So the relations of the bony part, what are the relations of the bony part? Superiorly comes the middle cranial fossa. Here comes the middle cranial fossa. Inferiorly, here is the parotid gland. Posteriorly is the mastoidantum. Posterior to this is the mastoidantum. Anteriorly comes the temporomandibular joint. Medially is the tympanic membrane. And laterally, the cartilaginous external arteries. So I will repeat the relations of the bony part of external aortic canal. Superiorly comes the middle cranial fossa. Inferiorly comes the parotid gland. Posterior to this is the mastoid antrum. That is why bony part has got a posterior relation to the mastoid antrum. That is why in case of acute mastoiditis, you will get a sagging of the posterosuperior canal wall. It's one of the clinical signs of an acute mastoiditis, because mastoid antrum lies posterior to the bony part of external aortic canal. You will get sagging of the posterosuperior canal wall in case of acute mastoiditis. So superiorly comes the middle cranial fossa, inferiorly the parotid gland, posteriorly mastoid antrum, ASLs and facial nerve, anteriorly comes the temporo part is the temporomandibular joint. Medially is the tympanic membrane, and laterally it is continuous with the cartilaginous external aortic canal. So the epithelial migration occurs from medial to the lateral side. Okay, that is it. From medially the epithelium migrate to the lateral side. So normally the wax will not get collected in the external aortic canal. It will migrate from medial to the lateral. Whenever you use buds or extra cleaning measures, then only this wax get collected and get embedded in the external aortic canal. Okay. Then nerve supply. The nerve supply of external aortic canal, you can draw like this. So right external aortic canal, this is your tympanic membrane. Cone of light, and this is the external artery. Usually external artery canal nerve supply we draw like this. So the tympanic membrane and the external artery canal. So it has got four nerve supply. Okay. Four. The main part, the anterior part, is by the auriculotemporal nerve. Auriculotemporal, what is that? It is the from the mandibular branch of trigeminal nerve, auriculotemporal. This floor is supplied by Arnold's nerve, 10, vagus nerve, Arnold's nerve, and posterior part is supplied by C2-C3, that is greater auricular nerve. Greater auricular nerve supplies here, and small part at the posterosuperior surface is supplied by the facial nerve. Okay. Actually, so anterior part is by the auriculotemporal floor, and the posterior part is by the vagus nerve, and the posterior part by greater auricular through C2-C3, and posterior superiorly a small segment is supplied by the facial nerve. Actually, so this is the nerve supply of external aortic canal.